My spiny ant colony, named the Blades of Midas. The Blades of Midas are an amazing ant colony with sharp spines that protrude from their bodies like warriors sporting black armor, ready for battle. But today we'll be watching the ants single-handedly battle a huge prey item, many times their size, and feed from its flesh. Just a warning, however, some scenes were a bit gruesome and maybe disturbing to some viewers. Welcome to the AntsCanada Ant Channel. Please subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon. Welcome to the AC family. Enjoy. AC family, last week we moved our new colony of spiny ants into their new terrarium kingdom we call Polyraxia. Today we're going to look at how they've settled in and what their lives are like in their new tropical forest floor kingdom. But I know most of you are here to witness the carnage between spiny ants and a roach, and so that is for sure coming up, so keep on watching until the end. Now before we go ahead and feed the roach meal to our spiny ants, let's have a look at the colony and how they've been liking their new home, shall we? An ant carries her deceased sister down the driftwood. She's actually been doing this for the past few hours, wandering the grounds of Polyraxia like a pallbearer, trying to figure out where she was going to place her dead sister. She climbed up a fern stalk. Now, ants usually have an established cemetery somewhere near the nest, where they usually dump all dead bodies. But it seems here in Polyraxia, the colony hadn't yet decided where they were going to set up their burial grounds. The ant wandered across the ferns as a forage fly over there waited for the ants to start dumping their dead bodies somewhere so she could eat and lay her eggs onto them. The ant crawled across every driftwood branch, back and forth, and couldn't decide where to place the dead body. At one point, I saw two ants coming together, each with dead bodies, and proceeding to follow each other. I could almost hear them saying, "Okay, maybe you know where we should be dumping these? They're heavy, sis." I'm actually unsure how or when the ants will decide where they'll set up their colony cemetery. But for now, it was quite funny to watch the ants carrying around the dead like they were on a mission with no end. There's one ant carrying a dead male ant. I actually spotted several dead male ants being carried around the lands. Usually, in the ant world, when you have a bunch of male ants die, it means they'd mated after having a nuptial flight. Does this mean the colony's males are mating with the virgin queens? If so, interesting. Perhaps we can expect an explosion of eggs soon. So here, right behind this pallbearer ant, you'll notice this test tube full of liquid. This is their sugar water food source. They visit this test tube like it's a flower, providing the ants some sweet nectar. They pretty much finish an entire test tube of sugar water like this every 1 or 2 days. These ants truly love their sugar, which is important to power their various daily activities. As for where the main colony is nesting, I'm actually not 100% sure, but it does seem like the bulk of the colony is living in and under the crumpled piece of paper towel in which they were already nesting when we first received them 2 weeks ago. Now, as mentioned in previous videos on this colony, these ants create mud and debris nests above ground, which makes them unique. They use the silk spun from their larvae to glue big balls and masses of mud and debris together to form these. I couldn't wait to see this happen in Polyraxia. If the spiny ants were indeed nesting in here, and they decided to stay in the paper towel, they'd eventually be forming their mud nest outward from here. We'll just have to see if that ends up happening. Otherwise, I was really hoping they'd nest somewhere in the driftwood. Right now, it doesn't seem like they're doing that just yet, though. But AC family, check this out! Inside this AC test tube portal, which used to be part of their initial setup, the ants had formed a satellite nest inside the freshwater test tube. Look at all those ants, all crammed in there. They've lined the interior with larval silk for comfort, which is why it's a bit hard to see through. But do you guys see what I see? A ton of cocoons, which only mean more workers are on the way. How cool. Now, speaking of ants in their nest, one thing I did notice was that other than these ants that were seen feeding in the sugar water test tube, and the various other ants carrying dead bodies wandering aimlessly, there weren't a lot of ants seen wandering around and about. It seems most of the colony was hiding inside their nesting spots. I knew there were a lot more ants than we could see here, because when we added them in last week, there was a massive swarm of hundreds of spiny ants. I began to wonder if some food might lure out the colony and cause them to start swarming. AC family, there was only one way to find out. Guys, the moment you've all been waiting for. Time to feed these girls. Let's do it. I placed the chopped up cockroach onto their main feeding platform. Now, despite me cutting it up and crushing its head, it seemed the top portion of the roach was still moving. Aw, man, it flailed its legs trying to right itself. I continued to watch to see how the ants would react to such a struggling prey item. Now, usually, I would chop ant food up until they are close to immobile, for cruelty reasons, but there is a value in keeping prey items just slightly moving, because it would allow us to see the ants' natural predatory behaviors come to surface, and I wanted to see if this moving prey item might summon a swarm of ants to come emerging from the nest. So far, it didn't seem like the ants discovered our roach yet. One of the pallbearer ants passed the moving roach. I'm sure she could smell it, but interesting to note that she didn't just ditch the dead body and start going in for the kill. Comes to show you what constitutes priorities in Blades of Midas society. Finally, an ant came crawling out from the paper towel to inspect the exposed roach flesh it could smell. I'm sure the ant could also feel the roach's flailing legs creating a vibration in the area. The ant followed her antennae, at first climbing the paper towel ball, and then proceeding forward to the roach. As the ant approached the inanimate part of the roach and went in for a taste, the head part of the roach began to swat it away. And the ant, clearly alarmed by this, began to spray formic acid onto the roach. As it arched its gaster under its body to shoot. Ouch! Must be painful. She began to bite the leg on the lower half of the roach and spray more formic acid onto it. The ant began to feed from the exposed guts of the roach's lower half as she filled up her social stomach, the contents of which would be regurgitated up for the rest of the colony, little by little, inside the nest. As the ant continued to feed, a second ant came out to inspect, and it cautiously approached the struggling roach. It needed to be careful of those flailing legs. It approached the exposed part of the roach and went in for a taste and sprayed formic acid into the guts. Ah, that must hurt. It broke away to inform the others. The first ant was done feeding now. Now check this out, guys. What you're seeing here is the ants sort of dragging their bodies around the roach, leaving pheromones to attract other ants to the area to come help them feed on the roach. As the ants were doing this, the roach finally seized the opportunity to attempt an escape. Hey, where did it go? The roach had successfully managed to crawl up onto the paper towel, despite it being split in half and head crushed. Crazy! Despite it falling on its back, it again managed to climb right back up. It scaled the rock wall, but ended up falling back onto its back. Throughout this whole ordeal, I did notice that the ants were still not swarming, like I had expected, and observed in most other ant species I've kept, it was evident that these spiny ants weren't so much swarmers when it came to food. Perhaps only when their nest was in danger, like when we first dumped the ants, nest and all, into this terrarium last week. At the moment, there were only a few ants taking care of business. It was a pretty gruesome yet riveting sight to watch. The roach tried on several occasions to get away, but it didn't stop the ants from feeding. When they were done, they returned to the nest to begin the food distribution of the pre-digested food they had saved in their bellies, while also calling other hungry ants to come out to have a bite to eat. It was amazing watching the ants feed on the dying roach, like lionesses feeding from a carcass. The ants were also diligent at making sure they took the time to clean themselves of the roach blood on their exoskeleton, because it had a sticky coagulant that, if left on their exoskeletons, could cause some serious gluey issues, which would be hard to remove later. Plus, it was an invitation for mold and bacteria on their bodies, which was undesirable and unhygienic. As I watched the spiny ants feed, although it was sad to watch the roach die, it made me happy that our ants were receiving the nourishment the colony needed to survive. In nature, I acknowledge that there is no immoral or moral. Life dies and gives rise to new life in a never-ending circle, and I have always felt blessed to have the opportunity to be able to witness it like this and film it all for you. I like to treat predation like all natural processes with respect. Though I still don't intend on offering my ants fully living prey, especially young colonies, for the safety of the ants, but for large mature colonies like our Blades of Midas, I don't find it too dangerous nor cruel to offer them partially mobile prey every now and then. What we watched here was all part of the spiny ant lifestyle, and it was cool to be able to observe it all with you. I will continue to feed and care for these ants over the next few weeks and see if they start building their iconic mud nests in other areas of Polyraxia. And if they do, you better believe I will be there to film it all. So until the next time we visit Polyraxia to experience the private lives of our beloved Blades of Midas, thank you all for watching and supporting the ants. It's ant love, forever.